Hey man, how do you keep your cell phone fireproof? Oh, okay. Wow. I never thought of it like that.
Now every lobe fighter is going to know we're coming in.
Hey, if they are smart, they will lie low. If not, standard AOEs apply. Do not fire unless they fire upon you. But if they do, put them down fast.
Amen to that.
Receiving fire. Receiving enemy fire.
Yeah, it wasn't incoming. Okay, that was incoming.
Brink was actually really, really interesting. If you can think about the moddability of all of your weapons in Call of Duty, the beautiful scenic areas of Team Fortress 2, how it plays, you know, how much fun it is, you know, it's a cult classic.
Crack cocaine, basically.
Crack cocaine, essentially. And Mirror's Edge. Combine all that together and essentially you have Brink. It changes the way that you interact with an entire environment. Instead of like, you know, oh, I'm gonna take cover, jump out, take cover again. No, I'm gonna run, dash, slide under the car, jump over the picnic tables, land on top of the guy, gun him down with my shotgun. It just combines the tried and true components of first-person shooters and just brings it all together with, you know, a new twist here and there.
Now, Brink uses those same familiar shooter controls that you're used to, but without the artificial constraints, because we've developed a new system that we're calling SMART. It stands for Smooth Movement Across Random Terrain. If you walk up to something that's an obstacle, just as you would do in any other shooter, you'll stop. But if you want to try and indicate to the game that you want to get somewhere as quickly as possible, using this SMART button, you're able to vault, mantle, and climb with ease. If you're approaching an obstacle, like a security sensor, and you want to make it through that obstacle without perhaps alerting the enemy to your presence, you could just look up, and you'll mantle up and over that automatically. And by the same token, if you use your same SMART button just running towards something and looking down, you'll indicate to the game that you're able to slide under something. And this is really important because in Brink, we want you to be able to make tactical decisions about where you go and how you play.
Another really inventive aspect of Brink is that it really encourages team gameplay. A lot of the objectives, like set this time bomb or open this door, it's all funneled towards this. And yet it feels very natural. It doesn't feel like a forced objective where, oh, I have to go do this or I have to do this. It just helps the team get along perfectly.
If I was playing soldier, it'd be my job to try and get that gate destroyed, but I'm playing operative, so I'm gonna use this objective wheel to find something cool to do that will help the squad. And for 300 experience points at the bottom, I can see interrogate the enemy. It's gonna give me an arrow at the top of the screen so I know where to go, what to do when I get there, and what my reward will be for success.
Compared to like Battlefield, like how big are these maps are you talking like?
The maps are
Call of Duty size?
Call of Duty, possibly a little bit bigger, not nearly as big as Battlefield, but at the same point, it's big enough where you don't feel crowded. I would compare it to a Team Fortress style map where there's a lot of obstacles in the area and a lot of different levels. And it has spies where you can, you know, dress up as the other characters.
So it is really TF2
It's heavily TF2 influence. You know, at the same point, you know, again, TF2 in terms of like you have your engineers who can, you know, set up turrets. You know, it really is a team-based game, and you know, if your team can make or break it.
Are you ready to use these, brothers?
I am ready.
Then let's do this.
Bethesda is one of my favorite game developing companies, and yeah, Fallout's a classic, Oblivion's a classic, but they're really breaking into the world of, you know, first-person shooters with this one.
Except for Fallout. and Elder Scrolls.
Well,
if you count bows and arrows.
Bows and arrows don't count.
El Shaddai, Ascension of the Metatron, it really caught my eye, and I found it to be the most interesting game at the show. The thing about it is the art style is like this insane, like surreal kind of like if you mix a kaleidoscope with like a Salvador Dali painting, but just made it anime.
It is a Japanese character action game based on the Dead Sea Scrolls. And I think people have heard of Dead Sea Scrolls, but don't really necessarily know what that is. And it is kind of these apocryphal books of the Bible that, you know, at the same time the Bible was written, these books were also written. And throughout history, most sects of Christianity have taken these books out. And it kind of tells an alternate version of Genesis, where God has created Earth, and he sent seven of his angels down to watch over the Earth. But the people started to worship those angels instead of God. And they build the Tower of Babel. So at the beginning of the game, God is like, we need to stop this. We're going to send the Great Flood down, Noah, the Ark, all that. And instead, Lucifer, who is still an angel at this point, he's not Lucifer, says, let's try something else. Before we send the Flood down, let's send Enoch. He's a human. He's like the most pure of heart human that ever existed. Send him down to meet those angels, bring their souls back to heaven. And that's you. And this level takes place in the Tower of Babel. And when you get here, you realize that it isn't normal tower. It's like this crazy, ethereal, abstract world. Because each of these angels has basically created a utopia inside the tower. Like, had they made the Earth, it would have looked like this. This is the realm of Ezekiel, and she's kind of obsessed with like clouds and trees and water. Yeah, basically it's a crazy, psychotropic journey through random abstract worlds created by angels. Yeah, as you go through ancient biblical apocrypha as told through a Japanese anime lens, basically. You kind of end up with like Evangelion meets Kingdom Hearts meets a Studio Ghibli movie, and it's really out there, but it's something different. And the levels are kind of a mix of, this level is very straightforward, you're kind of on a path, but the level before this one is really wide open,
yeah.
And there's lots of puzzles in it. And then after this next part, you'll get to a 2D level. And like in the beginning, there aren't a lot of the 2D levels, but towards the end of the game, there's a ton. About a third of the game is actually side-scrolling. Well, you know, the guy who made this, his name is Sawaki Takayasu. He was the art director on Okami. This guy is doing something graphically very different than what everyone else is trying to do. Like, instead of trying to make realistic graphics, he's making surreal graphics. You notice there's no, you know, on-screen indicator. And that's on purpose. We want you to pay attention to the graphics. So you'll see, when you get hurt, your armor actually is going to fall off you in pieces. Pay it Japanese. The game is very Japanese.
Miro. また奇妙な奴が出てきたぞ これはベイル 奪い取ってみるといい
You also notice you're out of armor, so if you can hit one more time, just press all the buttons, go back. So every time you die in combat, you can come back by pressing those buttons, but it gets harder every time.
What it plays like, though, is it's like Ninja Gaiden. But imagine Ninja Gaiden with, like, kind of like the Assassin's Creed, like, timing-style button presses. So there's only one attack button. But what you have to do is you have to press it in different ways, and you'll do these different attacks.
And even though there's only the one attack button, there's a lot of combos. There's about 23 combos, all based on timing. Like, if you attack once, then pause, attack again, you'll jump behind an enemy, break his guard. So that's Lucifer. He's talking to God on the cell phone there. He kind of serves as your save point.
Well, what kind of cell phone is Lucifer using? Is it his iPhone?
It's kind of big. No, like, if you look at it, it's
old 80s style.
Yeah, it's a little bit 80s style, you know? We don't know what year he went to get his designer jeans and his cell phone. It might have been like 1994.